I'm here with Frank from Belford Weapon. How are you doing, Frank?
I'm doing great. How are you? And yeah, I'm Frank from Belford Weapon, and thanks for having me. Stoked to be here.
No problem at all. It's great to have you. So let's go into, obviously, your project, which you've been doing for some years now. When did Belford Weapon start?
Oh, wow. Belford Weapon actually started in like 1999.
Wow, amazing.
Yeah, a long time ago. And yeah, I started with a drummer named Steve Sams at a place called the Jambox in Seattle, where a lot of bands rehearsed there, and hooked up with this drummer, and we started jamming out, and ended up with this singer came in and didn't really work out. And then we ended up with a bass player who came in. His name's Ben Leyland. And from there, we ended up getting a lead guitar player. His name was Keith. I forget his last name. And he was friends with Steve, and he moved up from California. And then we got this singer named Brett. And it was this really killer lineup at the very beginning, and had some tunes going and worked out some stuff. And then it just kind of parted ways after a while before anything really got going. And it's just, yeah, it's kind of how that went, how that went down. And then I moved on with some friends that were in other bands to help me record some material that we had going. Me and the singer, Brett. And got some a drummer from a band called Uncle Betty at the time, One Less Human, and the bass player Russ Cumbie was his name, and then I ended up making like a 3-song demo way back in the day, and that's where it all started, actually. Yeah,
amazing. So you've got a lot of history with the band as well. So that's incredible.
Yeah, there's quite a bit of history to it. Yeah, it's been a ride, that's for sure.
So in terms of your songwriting then, how does that all work then in the project with the current lineup, for example?
How I do it now? So how I do things now, I basically just sit around and jam out and come up with some riff ideas. And once I have a few riffs going, then I just sit down on my computer with my interface, and I have a drum program. I just start laying out some scratch tracks for the rhythms and putting some drums to it. And then I just start mapping out the music. And a lot of times I'll grab riffs from other ideas I have and see if they fit. And other times I'll just on the fly write riffs that I'm looking for. And it's kind of, my ears kind of tell me what to do. It's weird. I don't know how to explain it. I just start with basically one or two riffs with drums, and I just build off of that. And I stick with a pretty simple formula, but it just gets done in a different way. Basically like an intro, verse, pre-chorus, chorus, bridge, verse, pre-chorus, chorus, solo part, and then thing again, verse, chorus, then ending. But I just do it in different ways. So that's how I do the writing now. In the past, I used to write with a drummer, me and Steve, Steve Sams, the first drummer of Belford Weapon. We would sit down and just work stuff out together, me and him, and structure everything out. And I would write to his beats. But I don't do that anymore. I'd love to. I wish I could do that, especially with Brian. Oh, my God. Mm-hmm. I wish I could sit down and jam with that guy. And we could come up with great stuff. But that's how the writing process goes for me. And I just structure out the music. Once the music's structured out to where it feels like a song, and then it goes to everybody else from there.
Amazing. That's so cool. And what have been your influences, I guess? So what has been the music that has truly inspired you?
Oh, man, so many bands. Oh, my God. Metal Church, Overkill, Exodus, Testament, Morbid Angel, Deicide, Nile, Nevermore. Oh, God, I can go on and on and on. But what influenced me to go the vocal direction that's now incorporated with Belford Weapon is Iced Earth and Into Eternity. Those two bands, when I was doing the album or the EP Raining Plague, I was listening to those two bands quite extensively. It was kind of an accident how it happened, because there was one song in particular, the song Raining Plague. I was just hearing like a clean part in one section of the song. And the singer that I had for that, Dean Sternberg, he was like, man, I'm hearing clean vocals all over this music. And I'm just like, well, shit. let's hear what you got, because, you know, who knows what's going on in his head. And once he started giving me the ideas that he had going, it actually worked. And I thought, well, shit, you know, let's just go with it. So that's how that whole thing came about.
Wow, amazing. And so you've got some really great people in the current lineup. Did you want to let us know who they are?
The current lineup that I have going right now, yeah, is Craig and Lum on lead guitar, Brian Newberry on drums, Stu Block on vocals, and Mike LaPond on bass. And amazing lineup. And I really love the song that we just did, Tortured Within. And the next one coming out, that song is called Rise from Eternal Darkness. And it's a lot different than Tortured Within. It's got more of a brutal death metal, very fast tempo music with more of a black metal, thrash metal vocal style that Stu did on that.
Amazing. That's so cool.
And the lineup. Go ahead.
I was going to say, and so it's really cool to see that you are creating some dynamic as well. So, you know, it's like you're not sort of sticking to just one style. You're exploring, you know, which is great. I think it takes a lot of courage to do that. It's great that you have such versatility in how you write and looking at different moods and styles. That's fab.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah, I love so many different styles of metal that I listen to, and it's cool to take different styles of the music and incorporate it in my writing, and then the vocals being a little different. Yeah, there's a lot of different styles going on with it, and it seems to work, though. It's not like so crazy out of the norm where it doesn't make sense to people. It's so each song's a little different. Like, some people might like this song but not like this song, or vice versa, you know. And but yeah, it's just a lot of fun, and get to working with these great musicians is an honor, and it's a lot of fun. They're so easy to work with, it's so professional, and it goes very smoothly, the working process, which is nice.
Yeah, I can imagine. And what would you think would be the best thing for your band? What kind of things do you want to happen for the future?
Well, what I would love to see happen, I would like to eventually get a record deal behind me. I don't know if that's ever going to happen or not. But to where I at least get some funding for putting out the music itself and the recording. And I want to play festivals. And with the guys involved with the new lineup and even the old lineup with Ark and Demise, everybody's in big bands and they're busy with that. So it's hard to like get these guys to like commit to the band and go out and do like full on tours and whatnot. Totally understandable, but I could see us definitely getting on festivals and becoming, you know, like a festival type band. That's my goal, is to incorporate into that and possibly get some funding to do the recordings and to take care of that. That would be my ultimate goal to see happen. That would be really cool.
Awesome. So you've got some great ideas for the band and everything. So a couple of things, in terms of obviously the two tracks that you've written, so far, how have they been received by your fans?
Oh, pretty good. Tortured Within has done really good. I'm getting a lot of good positive feedback from that. And I'm still getting positive feedback from the Dark and Demise songs too. The song Eternal Fire, that seems to be one that people really like a lot. Mm-hmm. And that's had the most views on the YouTube, and you know, that's a special song in a few different ways. One of the biggest things is that's the last song that Tim Amir recorded before he passed away. Oh. You know, that's very special to me in regards to that. So, rest his soul. But what an honor to work with him and everybody else that I've worked with, too. It's been a great experience, and it's cool to see this thing kind of grow a little bit and starting to get a little recognition and people appreciating what I do. It's really cool.
Yeah, that's fab. And so has there been any moments in Belfred Weapon where you've been like, wow, this is the best thing that's ever happened? You know, like, for example, has there been any peak moments in your journey?
Oh, yeah, for sure. The making of Dark and Demise was definitely one. And what I've just currently released with Torture Within, and I'm I'm really excited to release the next song too, which should be done in probably a couple months, the beginning of January. I'll be releasing that. The lyric video is being created right now, and the guitar solo should be done in the next couple weeks. Cragen's taking his time working out the parts on that. That actually has two solos in it. There's a in the solo section, I put a chorus in the middle of it, so there's kind of like a solo and then a chorus and then solo again and goes back into the. Yeah, and playing live too. The last time Belford played live was in 2017. We did a couple shows with Ghost Ship Octavius, Everett, and Tacoma. Those were fun. And but the highlight of that tour was when we on the third night we played in Seattle at Studio 7, opened for Morbid Angel. That was really cool. Oh,
wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, that was probably the highlight of Belford's live. We also played a festival a long time ago in 2005, Louder, Harder, Faster Festival that Tammy Taylor was involved with putting that together, and she put us on the bill, which was really cool of her to do that. And that was a blast. I mean, a two-day, three-day party. It was crazy.
That sounds amazing.
Played with Testament and all kinds of other bands, Mushroom Head, Nuclear Assault, Macabre. I think Obituary was there too. Yeah, a whole bunch of bands. Yeah, that was great.
Amazing. And you yourself has done promotions as well, haven't you? So you've got a bit of history with putting on shows.
Yeah, I did that from like 2003 to 2009. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had two festivals I did each year, the Northwest Death Fest and the Seattle Metal Fest. And then amazing. I did some regular shows. Yeah, I booked a lot of cool bands, you know, Obituary, Overkill, Testament we did, and Metal Church, Death Angel, Nevermore. Just to name a few. I could go on and on, but it was cool. The Accused, I did a show with The Accused, just as a show with them at 4 in the afternoon at a place called the Phoenix Underground. That was a great show. A whole bunch of people showed up for that. I had a lot of fun doing that. I kind of miss it, but it was a lot of work, and it was a great experience, and I have a lot of cool stuff that bands given me, t-shirts and signed albums and
amazing
stuff to add to the collection. Yeah, it was a blast. A lot of work went into those.
Yeah, they do. I think festivals really do. You've got to put in so much time and effort, and, you know, but it's incredible that you did that for so long. And, you know, I'm sure, I mean, do you feel like that helped and contributed to contacts and things like that?
Oh, absolutely. For sure. I met a lot of cool people in the industry. That's how I met Steve DiGiorgio. As I booked Thetis, I put them on two festivals. And he was a super cool dude. And the band was really cool. John Allen and Travis hung out with those guys. It was awesome. And then when I went to do Raining Plague, I just thought, I'll just message Steve DiGiorgio and see if he would be interested in playing bass. What's the worst that's going to happen? He's going to say no. Okay. Which is what I figured he would do, but no, he actually responded and said, yeah, send over what you got, the demos. And of course, in a week and a half went by, I didn't hear anything back. I'm thinking, yeah, he probably was like, yeah, a bunch of bullshit. You know? But no, he actually goes, yeah, man, sounds good, and I'd be more than happy to do it. And that was a really cool deal. And then Frederick Wittigs, who played for Marduk for a while. He recorded drums for the Belfed EP, Raining Plague. And then right after that, he got offered the gig in Marduk. And he went out and toured with them. So that guy's a beast of a drummer, too. And, that was just such a great experience. And then my friend Andy Beach, who of Dehatri Guitars, which is one of his creations right here. I don't know if you could see this or not.
Oh, amazing. Yeah, that's gorgeous.
Yeah, it's got the tiger.
Yeah, I love that. That's a really cool design. Yeah.
Is the Belfed guitar. I do all my writing and tracking on this.
Amazing. And what kind of instruments do you use? And what makes are these?
This is a Dehatri. That's the name of his custom guitars. That's my main Belfed choice for guitars. And I love the Kramer Stage Masters, which is one I have right here. This is a beautiful.
Oh, it's lovely. Yeah.
Yeah, I've been looking a long time for one of these, and I finally found it. Buddy of mine, and we made a deal. Yeah, and I love the Jacksons too. I have quite a few Jacksons. So yeah, mm-hmm. and I have a couple of deans. One of my favorite deans is the Rusty Cooley. I think it's the Exenocide model. I think that's how it's pronounced. Seven string, fucking mm-hmm. awesome guitar. And it's the last one that Dean had in stock, actually brand new, and I ended up getting it. So that was pretty cool.
Yeah, that sounds so cool. So in terms of in terms of your recording, do you go into a studio? How does that all work?
Yeah, I do all my demoing at home, just with scratch tracks and program drums. Mm-hmm. And then sometimes I'll send the program, just the scratch track guitars and the program drums to Brian. Mm-hmm. I think with Dark and Demise, I ended up just giving him the scratch tracks and then the program drums just as an example. And then I sent him the files with just the guitars and then let him do his thing completely on that. Mm-hmm. And so I go into the studio to track real guitars, and like with Tortured Within and the next new one, I went in and did the guitars first to my program drums and got those really solid, and then gave Brian the real guitar track. So it could go either way.
Yeah. That's cool. So you've got kind of like a good setup for recording and everything. What has been the most what has been the best recording experience for you and why?
Well, I've actually done all my recording with Aaron Smith and in Vintage Audio. He's in Seattle, and I've worked with him on the Peacekeeper EP and the Raining Plague EP and the Dark and Demise and the new stuff. So he's pretty much been my recording, and I love working with Aaron. He's real easy to work with. And we sit down, and it's just like he's got a great ear, and he's just he pushes me a little bit, and he has some input a little bit in some of the stuff that I'm doing, and he's had some really good suggestions that have contributed into the writing. And one particular song, Black Matter Clarity, off of Raining Plague, he actually contributed a riff in that song. It's kind of got like a Testament kind of vibe to it.
Oh yeah.
So yeah, he just pulled that out of his ass one night, and it totally worked and fit. And yeah, so I really like working with Aaron a lot, and he's pretty much the guy that I've always worked with. So always been a Grant.
Nice. And what sort of media coverage have you had so far? So I know you've been getting some great reviews, a bit of plugging here and there and stuff. So what's going on with your media side of stuff?
Yeah, I've had a good experience with Zach Moonshine with MDPR. He does really good, and I've gotten a lot of some write-ups in the magazines and a lot of the online magazines posting it, and a lot of radio play, and it's really cool. And I've had quite a few people reach out wanting some interviews, which is amazing. And it takes a long time to really get your stuff out there, because there's a million bands trying to do the same thing, you know, and it's not an easy gig, you know, for sure. But you know, I do it because I love it, and whatever happens, it's all good, you know. It's fun, and it's just great to work with such good musicians and people of this caliber that I grew up listening to my whole life, and now I'm working with them, and what an amazing experience.
Yeah, that's incredible. And I'm sure, you know, that it makes you feel good listening to your music and thinking, wow, you know, I've got some of these amazing musicians in my music, and, you know, we're getting some good reviews and feedback, and it must be very elevating for you, you know?
It really is. And I do a lot of walking, you know, right now, because I'm off work, and whenever the weather's nice, I go out and walk, and and I listen to a lot of music, and I'm always throwing on Belfed Weapon, Tortured Within. I still listen to that song quite a bit, and it's just a great tune. And then, you know, in my rotation, another Belfed Weapon songs come on, and it just blends really, really good with all the other stuff I listen to, and it is cool. It's like, wow, that's my song. It's like, that's pretty cool.
That's amazing. That's so cool. And so, like, what is your favorite song then out of everything that you've recorded? What means the most to you?
Oh, wow. I have so many, but I would have to say the one that hasn't been released yet, the next one coming out, Rise from Eternal Darkness, that's probably my favorite song out of everything that I've done. And it's not even quite done yet, but where it's at today, I listen to that, it's like, wow, And the lyrics are amazing. And next to that, I would have to say Eternal Fire. You know, because, you know, that's a very special song. And with Tim's being, that's his last song that he recorded on. Man, rest his soul. It's just like, you know, what an honor to be able to work with him, because Control Denied is one of my favorite bands. You know, Chuck Schuldiner is a musical genius, and rest his soul too. And what an honor to be able to work with someone from one of my favorite albums. Control Denied is up there, very high up there with my favorites for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Great band. Great band.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So if, say, for example, you were giving advice to, say, I don't know, a young musician that wanted to, you know, get involved in music, what would you say to them? What are the things you've learned along the way?
Wow. Well, brace yourself for a long, hard road, for one. I could almost say don't do it, but I would never say that, because it's like, if that's what you want to do and you believe in yourself, then don't hesitate to stop, and don't let anything or anybody get in your way from following your vision and your dream. And be prepared to get slapped in the face and slapped in the face again and a couple more times. And eventually you'll get a nice big wet sloppy kiss, and, you know, it might actually feel good at times. It's a long, hard road.
Yeah, I would agree.
Don't give up. That's what you love to do and you believe in it. Follow your passions, follow your dreams, 100%.
Yeah, no, I agree. Because I think it's the road that actually builds your character as well, you know. I think you are always going to get sort of highs and lows in bands. And yeah. I feel like even when you're going through the hard stuff, it'll build your character up, and you'll learn about people, you'll learn about your boundaries, or you will learn about what works for you, what doesn't work for you. And remember, I mean, this is one thing that I do say to a lot of bands, you know, especially people that are sort of on their way up and doing really well for themselves. You know, you will be surrounded by people that can be happy for you and people that won't as well. So it's just remembering that you're doing this for you. You're doing this for, you know, what you enjoy doing, because a passion will always drive you anyway. You know, it's like, for example, when you're picking up, you know, your guitar and how that feels when you create a great riff, you know, it's that feeling, isn't it? Like, you know, when you come up with a great riff and you're excited about it, and, you know, you want to put it into a song. And, you know, I think those moments, I think, are so special.
Yes, I agree 100%. Yeah. I've written some new riffs lately, and I've been trying for the last couple of months. Nothing's coming. All of a sudden I got like 3 or 4 new riffs going. I'm like, oh, there's a couple songs right there. I already know that they're going to be songs. It's just, that's all it takes is 1 or 2 riffs. And it's exciting to see one riff turn into a whole piece of music. It's a great feeling. But yeah, you're going to get let downs. You're going to get your highs and your lows, and people are going to be so supportive of what you do. People are going to be bagging on what you do and this and that. That's just how it is. And you just got to accept that in the industry as well. And, you know, yeah, follow your passion. Don't let anything stop you, and stick to your passion, what you believe in. And you know what? And one thing I would advise anybody getting into this is, you know what, do what you love to do, and it doesn't matter what anybody thinks.
Yeah, absolutely.
And don't have any expectations. Just go, you know what, I want to put out an album, or I want to put together a band and play shows. Well, do that, and don't expect anything out of it other than just having fun.
Yeah. And then if something really good comes out of it, it's a bonus, right? So
absolutely bonus, because if you have expectations, I've seen it before with a lot of people. They get these high expectations. I've had it myself. 100%. Like, oh man, I put out the song. Oh man, it's going to do killer. People are going to love it. And, you know, and it doesn't quite do what you think it's going to do. And that's just how it is. And you just have to understand that, you know what, just do what you do and have fun, because, you know, you have the expectations, you can end up with a big letdown.
Yeah. But I think also with having expectations, it's finding the right people to support you as well. I think I remember when, I mean, even with Mindlapse, you know, we had people that really didn't do much for us, and there's people that have gone over and beyond, you know. So it's working with the right people, I found, certainly with, you know, trying to promote what you do and having those established bonds and things. So, yeah, no, totally. So what is next for Belford Weapon now then? So what's the plan? well, I suppose, your next step?
My next step right now is I'm just kind of regrouping a few things and working on new riffs. I'm taking lessons from a couple, like three different people right now. So I've got all these exercises going on and just trying to up my skills, writing some new riffs. And I'm working on starting to write some new songs. And it doesn't look like I might be going back to work anytime soon. Work's a little bit slow in my industry right now with election year and everything. And you know what? That's okay, because gives me a chance to start writing and getting songs. And I'm probably going to go into the studio in January with Aaron. We were talking the other day, and I'll get two songs written out, go in there and record those with him. At least I have two new songs to work on getting put out leading up to where I do a full length, because my goal is to do a full length record. And if I don't end up working all winter, which will be fine, because then it gives me a chance to write as many songs as I can. And if I can get two new songs written and recorded and then get 10 more done by the time summer hits, then I get everything recorded. Then I'm good to go. Then I go back to work and everybody can do their thing. And that's my goal to do. But if something happens where a job opportunity comes my way between now and springtime and it's worth taking, I'll probably take that. So to prolong that a little bit. But yeah, that's the goal, is to work on getting some more new music recorded in January and then get a full length written. And with the full length, that might be, you know, a couple of years before that's completely done. And I want to do a actual real music video with everybody. Full length record on vinyl, release it on vinyl, and hoping to get a record label to, you know, to support me on this. And if not, that's okay. I'll still put it out myself and keep going as planned. So, and then I want to be able to get ready to play some shows too. And everybody's on board with doing some shows if they're available. I've talked to everybody, and as long as everybody's available, don't have anything booked, they're more than happy to go play some festivals, some one-off gigs. Probably not doing any kind of full tours or anything like that, but that's okay. Makes it more special, you know. It's like to see Belfed Weapon, it'll be kind of like a, you know, once in a while kind of thing, you know. It makes it more unique too. So
I agree. Great ideas. And so I think you know, you've really shown a lot of strong commitment to your project. I feel like it's, you know, coming leaps and bounds. You've got some great ideas in the forefront. Is there anything you do outside the band to relax? Is there any hobbies that you do or anything like that?
Well, not too much, really. Honestly, I just like to play a lot, and you know, I go for walks and do that, and I love camping.
Amazing.
Not too much camping going on right now this time of year, but yeah, it's just nice to have a break from working so much, because I've been on doing construction. I get on these jobs with a lot of overtime, and I don't have much of a life when I do that. So to have this time off, had a few projects to do around my house, some carpentry work to do, to fix a couple things, and have time to actually sit down and play my guitars. That's been the biggest thing for me.
Yeah, amazing. That's so cool. That's great stuff.
Yeah, it is. It's a lot of fun. I love traveling and everything. And yeah, I can't wait to, my ultimate goal is to play 70,000 tons of metal festival. That would be, that's like my bucket list.
Yeah. I can imagine. Yeah. That looks great. I was looking at, you know, some of the lineups on that. That looks like an incredible festival, especially to be on a cruise ship as well.
I've never been on a cruise ship. So to go do that and to play it, I mean, that's a show that I would love to actually go to and buy a ticket to go see. But to get a Belfed Weapon on that would be like, yeah, that would be a dream. And then I'd like to play a festival in UK too sometime.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, we're going to be looking at doing Rage Fest as well. So I will let you know about that, and we can maybe sort something out.
I guess there's some festivals in Canada that look pretty cool too. This the other guy that interviewed me, I can't remember his name off the top of my head, but he really likes Belfed Weapon. He's like, yeah, there's some festivals up here you should really get on and whatnot. So I'm working on getting clearance to get in across the border. Another festival Zach Moonshine puts on is in Tennessee, Metal Devastation. Yeah, I'd like to play that festival too.
Yeah, that's really cool. Yeah, and it always looks great, doesn't it? I was looking at some of the pictures from the festivals, and you know, he does a really great job. So yeah, that's really good.
Yeah, he's all into the metal. Yeah, he's done great. So.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I think that's we're on around 30 minutes, so I think that's the interview done now. So just want to say thank you so much for the interview, and obviously good luck with everything with Belfred Weapon. I think you have a lot of passion for what you do. I feel like, you know, you're very deserving of getting a record contract. I feel like, you know, you have the passion and motivation for what you do, and it's fabulous to see. I think the music speaks for itself. It's very good. And obviously, you know, you're getting some great reviews and, you know, interviews. So keep at it. I think it's fab what you're doing.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And thanks for having me. And anybody listening and watching, if they want to support this project, I'm going to have some merch specials going here. It's getting set up on my website right now, beltfedweapon.net. Lots of cool merch to choose from. And, yeah, if anybody wants to support, feel free to, you know, buy some stuff. I throw in some extra little goodies, some guitar picks, stickers, and buttons with every purchase. And yeah, so it's really cool. And thanks a lot for having me. I had a lot of fun. I could talk about Belfed Weapon forever. So
that's great stuff. Yeah, no, it's been a pleasure, an absolute pleasure. Thank you so much for the interview.
Awesome. You're welcome. Thanks, Karina.
Okay, thank you.